Wow, the excitement has been dialed up to 10 today. As predicted, Starship Flight 11 has finally taken flight right on the date that had been initially announced over the past few weeks. There were some astounding firsts and many more lasts in this one, so grab something to snack on, sit back and get comfortable. This has been a busy day.
Okay, Neil, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
Hey, hey, Marcus House with you here, and with everything running smoothly, I left you just a few days ago watching Ship 38 being loaded with dummy Starlink satellites, and just hours after going live with that video, we were already watching it roll down to the launch site to be stacked with Booster 15. SpaceX posted these photos of it being lifted and placed on the Super Heavy with the sun low in the sky there. Absolutely gorgeous shot. Take a look at the heat shield though. We could now clearly see that there were strategically placed locations where they had removed the tiles all over it. For re-entry, these had been removed to intentionally stress test various areas across the vehicle to see how it holds up. Several of those missing tiles were in areas where they are normally bonded to the vehicle with no backup ablative layer, so this one was going to be nail-biting, especially with this one here at the forward flap aero cover. So, fast forward to the afternoon of flight, and here it was loaded smoothly, ready to go. We also had some nice angles of these tile experiments on the back side of the aft flaps there. Again, these tests were to do with tile adhesion. It has been exactly 1 year since the first ever Super Heavy booster catch, and I certainly suspect that this day was picked for that reason. The final countdown was on and SpaceX's live stream popped up here to present these absolutely breathtaking views right into the final moments. There were some beautiful new views hidden at the start of the stream showing version 3 equipment coming along, such as the integrated hot staging, some Raptor 3 test fire magic, hints of these version 3 Starlink satellites planned at some point, and a tile bakery spitting out Starship heat shield tiles at a rate of about 1,000 tiles per day right now. They are aiming for one tile every 13 seconds or 7,000 a day eventually. I was pleased to see Dan demonstrating the crunch wrapping here with a real tile as an example, and this ship had this pretty much everywhere possible. Anyway, today is all about Flight 11, so I'll dive into this stuff more on the weekend. The range was clear and the weather was not holding us back today. This, of course, is the very last time that we would see a Block 2 or Version 2 Starship launch from the pad. Not only that, the last time that we would see this circular pad supporting a launch, because after this flight, they are going to rip it all out and replace it with a full-on flame trench similar to what we see over here at Pad 2. It's all to prepare for the huge number of upgrades to Starship Version 3 and onward, and that includes the pad and the tower here getting ready for that. This was also going to be the last time that we would ever see this iconic inverted showerhead style water cooled system in place. Speaking of, check this out.
4, 3, 2, 1. We have liftoff. Go Super Heavy. Go Starship. Thanks for all the historic flights, Pad 1.
Yes, indeed, like a gigantic lightsaber, that Super Heavy thrust lanced through the atmosphere, propelling this monster up rapidly towards max Q, or maximum dynamic pressure. That's the point in flight where Starship is undergoing the maximum stress due to the speed and the atmosphere pressing in hard. After that point, the atmosphere really starts rapidly thinning out, so from here on, it was smooth sailing. It's just astounding, and I love covering all of this development every weekend because it is literally the most powerful rocket ever launched by a huge margin. We appreciate you being subscribed here and watching along because this is just magic for all of us. This has well over double the thrust of the Saturn V that took us to the moon over half a century ago. Along with the astounding success of the Falcon 9, this is really the first thing that has happened in spaceflight in many years that has us cheering on the future of exploration and missions to the moon and Mars. If you are unfamiliar, this monster is 9 meters wide, almost 30 feet, and a whopping 123 meters tall. Yeah, just over 400 feet. The dream of all this and why it is so exciting is that this is also going to be the very first rapidly and fully reusable rocket. This was, of course, Booster 15's second flight because this was the one caught by the tower on Starship Flight Test 8. It is the second time that a Super Heavy has ever been reused, so it was nail-biting for that reason alone. Out of all 33 Raptor engines there roaring away, 24 of them had been used in flight before, so it is wild to see them reusing so much hardware this early in this rapid prototype phase of the testing campaign. Neat onboard views once again here from Ship 38's forward flap cameras, and it really did look like a perfectly smooth ascent. That whole phase of the launch seemed to go really quickly because already the vehicle was orienting itself for the always exciting hot staging. They now have a blocked off part on this ring which gives a predictable push in this direction, and there it was, smooth again, and this means that the first stage gets this controlled flip in the optimal direction to more efficiently head back to the splashdown site off the coast. Now on this flight we did see one of those engines not light up as expected, but 12 were still pushing it along there no problem. This isn't the first time that we've seen this on a boost back, so there must be some persistent little issue there that will hopefully be solved on the version 3 Super Heavy to come next. Engine cut off there, and it was time to let go of the hot stage ring on top. Now this was the very final time that we would see this too. It has been wild seeing this over the course of 10 flights. The first full stack launch didn't have a hot stage ring at all, so this was introduced for flight 2. Releasing it like this was never a long-term plan though, because, well, then it's not a fully reusable vehicle, is it? No, for the upcoming generation of Starship, this hot staging system is all fully integrated. I can't wait to see that in action. Anyway, here we were watching the speed rapidly climb as gravity pulled Booster 15 down ever faster. Now there would be no catch on this flight of course, as was planned. Given that this was the very last Block 2 Super Heavy to ever fly, there was really no need to try to recover this. Instead, SpaceX wanted to do an experimental landing burn, sort of similar to what they did with Flight 10, but also a little different as well. As usual, they planned to ignite the landing burn with 13 engines, but unlike previous flights, they would then cut off only 8 engines from that middle ring of 10 and transition to 5 instead of the 3. This is to mimic the landing profile that SpaceX is going to use on the version 3 Super Heavy, so it makes sense that we would be seeing this tested on this final Block 2 flight. They would then cut 2 engines, ending up in a hover above the ocean. Once done, those Raptor 2s would also be shut down while still significantly above the sea level to let it destructively hit the water. Look at the speed of it ripping into the atmosphere there. The G-force is absolutely crazy. We were curious what the engine layout would be for the switch to 5, and we would soon find out. Check out this sequence.
Booster landing burn shut down.
And there we heard it. Booster landing burn shut down. We saw a 13-5-3 V3 demonstration. And into the water we go.
How cool is that? The Raptor that didn't ignite earlier had no issue with the landing sequence. Also, very nice to see the engine layout confirmed there of the 5 engines that then cut back to the 3. That formation will give them a load of pitch control on the catch, as well as, of course, redundancy if one of them was to flame out. All that looked to go nicely, and again, that data that SpaceX picked up on this last Block 2 Super Heavy will be incredibly useful for the next generation, I'm sure. Right, so rewinding to the hot stage separation, let's follow the Starship phase of the flight. Well, again, as we saw in Flight 10, that continued on as planned right through to engine cutoff, just shy of orbital velocity. Everything through the ascent looked beautiful, actually. We again had a Starship coasting along with those precise bursts of gases that we see keeping the control and orientation of the beast steady. Now, the next big event that we wanted to see was the deployment of the 8 dummy Starlink satellite simulator units on board. It would only be the second time to ever see this if they nailed it, so the question was, could they do it again? What we wanted to see was that payload bay door smoothly open. Indeed, we did. No issues at all, and right away the process to deploy those dummy satellites kicked off with wonderful camera views of all this once again. You can always guarantee SpaceX will share exquisite magic with all of these missions wherever possible. Last time we covered this, quite a few in the comments didn't quite seem to understand how each pair was being ejected. There are 2 units in each row here. The carriage moves forward, and the first of the 2 is released to drift out of the door. The The carriage then reverses back and quickly moves forward again to give the second satellite enough momentum before that is released. They then move down the still-to-be-deployed stack of satellites and do this process another three times to have all eight ejected out. SpaceX has obviously tinkered with the deployment process here because it was much more smooth than on the first attempt. None of them hit the door at all and barely even seemed to wobble on the way out. In fact, it looked much more like the renders that we've seen in the past. Now, the last dummy Starlinks to deploy had these interesting panels on top, and we can see these wires on the back, so I have a sneaking suspicion that SpaceX have tried to do something extra here, such as maybe setting up an external shot of the ship during the payload deployment. After that was all complete, the door was closed, and this time we got a bit of a better view of that closure, which was neat. Of course, the dummy satellites are, at this point, on the same suborbital trajectory as the Starship itself. These were all to simply burn up in the atmosphere. It is all planned this way as a test, which has everything just entering the atmosphere minutes later over the massive Indian Ocean area. Next up, of course, was the Raptor engine relight, and given that we had seen SpaceX do this successfully a few times now, there wasn't any reason to expect an issue with this one. There we go, now we just needed to await re-entry time. Now that process doesn't really start happening for another 10 minutes or so, and given that the Raptor relight changes the speed by roughly 60 kilometers per hour, all of those dummy satellites should be at least 10 kilometers or over 6 miles away at the time of entry. I have seen a number of people wondering if some of those dummy satellites may have the opportunity to hit the ship again at any point, but no, certainly not. Beautiful looking control here as the plasma started building up once more, and this time nothing popping around the engine chill lines on the aft of the vehicle, which is great to see. Along with that, SpaceX had learned their lesson from the metallic test tiles from the previous flight. We were not going to be seeing an orange coating on the ship after entry this time. Again though, the upper stage Starship here had several experiments focused on the future return to the launch site and catch. That plasma is just gorgeous, and without any damage to the aft area this time, this entire entry sequence was incredibly smooth. Given that Flight 10 showed the new forward flaps perform really well for the first time, we certainly expected that here again. If you have been following the changes to Starship in depth over the years, the Block 2 or Version 2 ship has these fins moved further forward on the vehicle and, more importantly, also further away from the windward side so that the plasma largely misses the aero covers protecting the hinge components holding these to the nose, which, of course, provides that intricate control. They were also slimmed down a little too, and given that we've seen them enter already without any sort of noticeable deformation or burn through on Flight 10, that has been a great design update. As we got deeper in toward maximum heating, it was lighting up the stream without any burn through on any of the flaps at all. Indeed, with no issues in the aft before entry, the aft flaps were looking great too. This was, without doubt, the cleanest entry that we have ever seen. I was watching to see if the tiles that had been removed to intentionally stress test various areas across the vehicle would show any visible difference to what we had seen before. We saw plenty of sparks and a little debris here and there, which was probably related to a lot of those missing tile spots, and Dan in the stream had informed us that they were literally trying to find the breaking point here. We were wondering if it would make it through at all, but this is a beast. I couldn't see anything specific that would indicate any serious damage from the onboard cameras. SpaceX is really trying anything that they can now to even better understand the heat shield performance, so yeah, it certainly makes each re-entry nail-biting. The only question remaining was could they kick off this new experiment in the descent? As SpaceX mentioned earlier, to mimic the path that a ship will take on future flights returning to Starbase, the final phase of the trajectory on Flight 11 was to include dynamic banking maneuvers. What they were doing here was testing out how the subsonic guidance programs functioned before the flip and landing burn would kick off. After that, the goal was to, as we've seen a number of times now, splash down in the Indian Ocean. That banking was awesome, and I'll just time-lapse the other big one here too at the 1 hour 2 minute mark. These were much more substantial manoeuvres than I expected, and sped up like this, you can see just how much they were changing Starship's path. They will be able to come in and then essentially circle back for a catch at the tower in future. It was now morning time way out west of Australia, and this view as it falls through the cloud layer blows my mind every time. The fact that those Starlink dishes attached to the ship allow this to be streamed in such high quality from launch right up to landing is really amazing, especially through that re-entry where we would previously have expected a communications blackout period. Anyway, the final seconds of flight ticked by, awaiting that iconic flip and burn, and for the last time, a version 2 Starship was about to do just that.
There's our landing burn. Three down to two.
Starship has landed.
Wow, that was another well-controlled looking soft splashdown, and great views there again from the ocean camera setup. Given that we saw that, we knew that it had all come down right on target. It all concluded with another expected fiery end for the ship, and that is it, my friends. What a show. So, with the last mission for the version 2 generation nicely wrapped up, we say farewell, not only to that, including the hot stage ring that has been jettisoned away over the last 10 flights, but also a goodbye to the current orbital launch mount. What comes next is going to be quite brutal, I suspect. We will see SpaceX rip that obsolete pad apart quite quickly, all while still continuing to finalise the installation of the new pad 2. Yes, we get to watch them march forward with the new Block 3 Starship, which is different and more capable in many ways. Integrated hot staging, Raptor 3s with higher thrust, a new launch pad with a monstrous flame trench. It is all coming very soon, and there's already plenty to dive into with all of this in Saturday's video coming. We have just seen the first ever nose cone for the next generation being moved into the bay to start stacking. Lots of fun, visible changes to dive into. So, I hope you enjoyed this video, of course. Thanks for being subscribed here and for those helping directly to support all of it. If you missed this video, do check it out here. Thanks for watching all this way through. As always, I will see you all in the next video.
We have liftoff, go Super Heavy, go Starship. Thanks for all the historic flights, Pad 1.